Good evening.
Good evening.
Tonight we are in Ezra 4. Going that far, huh? So there's this story, this chair, we wanted to be really important. And it thought, you know, where's the most important place I could be as a chair? So I wanted to be in church. And then it went to talk to the special chairs. We call them pews, but special chairs fits much better. So they went to talk to the special chairs, and then they said, you're not a special chair. You're just a regular old chair. So the chairs get mad. Yes, there's always something about a chair and WWE and WWF and Raw, and I'm trying to remember all the shows I watched. And they came at them with the chairs, right? And you know that's always the finishing moves when the chair comes at something. And the chair comes at the pew and beats up the pew. And everybody was beat down. Ezra 4 is a story about people not being allowed or being told they couldn't do something. And instead of going their way, instead of finding peace, they decide to be contentious. They decide that they're going to be contentious and they're going to do everything they can to attack the other ones. Because it starts out really good and they've got these great ideas and they're beautiful and excellent. And then they went smash, smash, smash on their ideas, so they're like, fine, we'll smash, smash, smash your ideas. And what happens is a very sad commentary on the work of God. Because they were trying to do something great. They were going to rebuild it. They're going to rebuild it so they could worship again, so they could serve God fully again. And because of these people who had been felt slighted, doesn't happen. Ezra chapter 4. Now when the adversaries of Judah and Benjamin heard the returned exiles were building a temple to the Lord, the God of Israel, they approached Zerubbabel and the heads of fathers' houses and said to them, let us build with you, for we worship your God as you do. And we have been sacrificing him ever since the days of Isahar, king of Assyria, who brought us here. But Zerubbabel, Jeshua and the rest of the heads of fathers' houses in Israel said to them, you have nothing to do with us in building a house to our God, but we alone will build to the Lord, the God of Israel, as King Cyrus, the king of Persia, had commanded us. Then the people of the land discouraged the people of Judah and made them afraid to build and bribed counselors against them to frustrate their purpose all the days of Cyrus, king of Persia, even till the reign of Darius, king of Persia. And in the reign of Ahasuerus, in the beginning of his reign, they wrote an accusation against the inhabitants of Judah and Jerusalem. So, you know, you understand the chair concept now, right? They were told that they couldn't build with them. They're like, we've been worshiping your God. We actually want to help you build this temple. And Zerubbabel, I don't know why I keep saying that one. Zerubbabel comes to him. And he answers. And he says, no, this is something we're going to do. You know, we've been set apart to do this. And they respond a lot like the modern church does. A lot like people do when they're told, you know, you have these ideas, but you can't do it. So what do? They try to frustrate them. They try to stop them. They try to bribe counselors, frustrate them, do anything they can to stop them, and then they try one more approach. Verse 7. In the day of Artaxerxes, Bishlam, and Mithridat, and Tabeel, the rest of the associates wrote to Artaxerxes, king of Persia. The letter was written Aramaic and translated. Rahum, the commander of Shimshai, the scribe, wrote a letter in Jerusalem to Artaxerxes, the king, as follows. Rahum, the commander, Shimshai the scribe, and the rest of their associates, the judges, the governors, the officials, the Persians, the men of Erech, the Babylonians, the men of Susa, that is the Elamites, and the rest of the nations, whom the great and noble of Snapper forfeited, and settled in the cities of Samaria, and in the rest of the province beyond the river. This is a copy of the letter that they sent. To Artaxerxes the king, your servants, the men of province beyond the river, send greeting. And now, be it known to the king that the Jews who came up from you to us have gone to Jerusalem. They are rebuilding this rebellious wicked city. They are finishing the walls and repairing the foundations. Now be it known to the king that if this city is rebuilt and the walls finished, they will not pay tribute. Custom or toil, and the royal revenue will be impaired. Now because we eat the salt of the palace, and it is not fitting for us to witness the king's dishonor, therefore we send and inform the king, in order that search may be made in the book of the records of your fathers. You will find in the book of the records and learn that this city is a rebellious city, hurtful to kings and provinces, and that sedition was stirred up in it from old. That was why the city was laid waste. We make known to the king that if this city is rebuilt and its walls finished, you will then have no possession in the province beyond the river. How many of us have started to see ourselves in this story a little bit? Started it. Because most of us at a time when we felt wrong, we felt cheated, we felt like we were left out of something. Instead of looking at something and saying, you know what, it's a good thing. It's a good work. And I don't know, you know, whatever work it was you're excluded from. But it was a good work, and all of a sudden, you've taken this approach, and you said, well, you won't let me participate. And it became I didn't get what I want. These are adult grown people in this story. These are elders. These are pretty much those ruling at the time. They are living this out. They have been stationed there to set up under the king. And all of a sudden, it went from, you know what, we want to help you. This is a great work. We understand how important this is, to, you know how terrible it is. You know what happens if they rebuild this. King, you have to understand, if they do this, we're not going to have salt from you. We're not going to have those things that you give us. We won't have your royal protection. We won't have your rule over us, because guess what? They'll rebel against you, King. You've got to listen to us. You've got to stop this thing that 5 seconds ago I was super excited about. And so they sent the letter. And in this letter, so quick a turnaround, because the second they're told they can't serve, all of a sudden they've got this idea they're going to write to the king and stop this. And the final state is what we want to see. Verse 17. The king sent an answer to Rehum, the commander, and Shimshai, the scribe, and the rest of their associates who live in Samaria, and in the rest of the province beyond the river. Greeting, and now the letter that you sent us has been plainly read before me, and I made a decree, and search has been made, and it has been found that this city from of old has risen against kings, and that rebellion and sedition have been made in it, and mighty kings have been over Jerusalem, who ruled over the whole province beyond the river, to whom tribute, custom, and toll were paid. Therefore make a decree that these men be made to cease, and that this city be not rebuilt, until a decree is made by me. And take care not to be slack in this matter. Why should damage grow to the hurt of the king? Then when the copy of King Artaxerxes' letter was read before Rehum, and Shimshai the scribe, and their associates, they went in haste to the Jews of Jerusalem, and by force and power made them cease. Then the work on the house of God that is in Jerusalem stopped. And it ceased until the second year of the reign of Darius, king of Persia. Though this story is about the temple, it is about, it fits with a lot more things. I mean, because when he shows up, what are they doing? What are they saying? What is the reason they actually want to help rebuild the temple? Because they're serving God. When they show up to rebuild the temple, the only reason they ask to do it is not, well, we really think it'd be a pretty building. I want to help you out. I want to be part of a pretty building. I like working. This is not what they said. They come up and they said, we serve the same God you do. We want to join with you because we understand that this God is the one we wish to serve. And their focus was this. When this story starts, you have these people though not Israelites, are serving God. They're actually focused on God, and their intention is to do what is good for the Lord. And all of a sudden, they step up. They step up and say, you know what? Because we serve God, we want to do something. Because we serve God, because God is our focus, we want to do something. Then they get told no. And the Christian godly thing to do at this point would be to say, okay, well then how can we help you? It would be for these chairs to go, you know what, I'm going to sit outside Rosemary's office, theoretically. This is not specifically here, but you understand the concept. My job is, I'm going to be a chair, and I'm going to sit outside Rosemary's office. And I'm going to be out there in case somebody needs to sit down. Somebody comes in from outside, and they're tired, and I'm going to do that. I understand I'm not a pew. And I understand that my job may be not as elevated as the magic church chair. But they say, you know what, if I can't be a magic church chair, I'm going to be a chair that sits out front. I'm going to be a chair that's there for somebody who needs it. That would be a godly response. And if they had kept their focus and it had stayed the same in the beginning and they said, I want to serve God because I want to serve God. I want to do this because of God. If they kept that focus, then honestly they would have acted like chairs and said, hey, you know, what position can I do? Can I clean up some of the rubble? You know? Can I, you know, do anything? Can I, you know, take care of the outside? What can I do? How can I serve this God who I want to serve? But that wasn't what they did. They got distracted and they focused on themselves. And when they focused on themselves, you know what we call it? I'm going to serve God. It's, you remember that king we used to serve? King Artaxerxes, the great. And instead of, you know, pleading with God and going, well, God, where do you want me to serve? What they did is they went over here. And they twisted everything. These godly intentioned people went over here and they got slighted, and all of a sudden, they start twisting it. Artaxerxes, you know I'm going to rebuild this. I thought you wanted it rebuilt. I thought you said you just served God. I thought that God was the most important thing. And yet now you're saying, God doesn't need this temple because I can be part of rebuilding it. And the final result is this. It stopped being built. They succeeded. But if you went back to them and you said, before they were ever building the temple, and they were like, okay, you serve God, and said, you know, one day there's going to be a temple rebuilt and they won't let you build that temple with me. Would you still serve me? How many of them are going to go, nope, God, I can't stand you. I'm serving you now, but if at any time you don't let me serve you, I'm just going to turn against you. That's not something any of us think, is it? You don't go to church and go, you know what, I'm going to serve God unless I feel slighted, and then at that point I'm going to destroy everything. But by the end of it, they had succeeded. They had succeeded in doing what they should have never wanted to be done. They succeeded at doing that thing that was against the God they said they were worshiping. And it's more a matter of, you see their focus just shift the whole time. From, God, I want to serve you, and if you want me to wait tables, I'm waiting tables. When we look at Christ, Christ does this weird thing of saying, so you want to be great? Okay, let me show you some really exciting stuff. I mean, we're going to make it exciting. I mean, let's talk about the power of God. Are you ready? We're going to take a towel and some water and some soap and wash some feet. You want to be great? Here it is. Let me show you this new towel I got. It's great for washing feet. Or you look at the Apostle Paul. In the letter to the Corinthians. And you think about that craziness that he starts out as. The craziness of Paul telling everyone, yeah, he's an apostle. Yeah, he's least. His job is, he's like, I am the great apostle. I am here to serve as your servant. I am a slave to everyone. I'm going to be a slave to the Jews. I mean, I'm going to follow laws that I think are pointless and don't follow otherwise. I'm going to do all those crazy things because, you know what? I'm a slave to them. Then he says he's going to be the slave to the Gentiles. Those who don't have this knowledge of God. He is a student of humanity. He's not just some, you know, run-of-the-mill Jew. This is a student of humanity. He talks about this. He says, you know, the Corinthians should be recognized again. If they want to do it on basis of credentials, he has them. But then he says, and I count it all as loss for the cause of Christ. And he takes that and he says, I'm an apostle. I am the slave of Gentiles and Jews. And the whole of Christianity is about taking the norm, the idea of what makes somebody great, what makes somebody better than somebody else, and it just flips it on its head. It says, if you want to be great, you need to be a servant. You want to be the greatest in the kingdom? Fine, serve people better than everybody else. And so Jesus, as the example, he says, imitate him. And when we imitate Christ, the only thing we can really follow that Jesus is doing is he just keeps serving. Well, okay, right now he's ready. He's got command of the angels. They're beating him. Okay. He's just taking it. Okay. Well, I mean, that's not really, you know, God being powerful. Okay. No, wait, they're crucifying him. Well, that's not really God being powerful. He's God. He can stop this. He has the command of angels. We know this. He is God in the flesh. There is no reason for this. And then all of a sudden, he's dead. It's not really God. God doesn't do that. God has this powerful lightning, sits on his throne, majesty, holiness. Submits to death because you know what? He's God. He's the only one. If somebody's going to kill me, they're going to succeed whether I want them to or not. If they want to try hard enough, I'm going to die. It doesn't work that way with Christ. It's not as though they came against Christ and they were so powerful we couldn't stop them. No. There was plenty of power in Christ to stop the whole thing. There was plenty of power in Christ to say, hey, wait, this is not what God does. But it's not. He shows us what a servant is. Because he serves to the point of giving up his life to people who he dearly had to help them out. He had to help them out just so they could crucify him. He's like, you came against me. It's me. I'm right here. They come to the garden and he doesn't go, which one of us is it? Huh? Figure it out. No, he goes, I'm right here. I preached in your synagogues. You've seen me. Here I am. Take me. Leave these ones alone. Tells Peter, put that sword away. This needs to happen. And if we maintain the thought that we want God glorified, how different would our images be of things? How different would our service be if we said, God, I want you glorified, and if the best thing for your kingdom is a slight against me, I'd rather serve you and be slighted. I'd rather serve you and feel like I should get to do that than to fight against God and his church and everything he dies for. Because most of the New Testament is not actually positive. Most of the New Testament is intentionally written because stuff is messed up. And most of them go back to a word we talked about this morning. Love. Because they couldn't figure it out. How did Paul has this ingenious idea. He's going to stop fighting. He actually has an amazing system in Corinthians 16. He's got this idea. This idea is that if they practice love and they put others first, and they're ready to serve, and they're ready to be the servants of everybody, the church will be helped by it. And so we do learn something very humanly from Ezra. Is that honestly, if we want to fight against God, we are very effective. We're a lot more effective than anybody else in the world. Some Satan is getting up on Sunday morning and putting a hairdryer on somebody. Doesn't really do that much. I don't even care. It's called unbaptism. It's a new little thing. They have it on the internet. And they do. They get these hairdryers and dry people off. It's called unbaptism. It's really good. I was laughing, and I should have been laughing, but I was laughing. It's very bad. And so they just have these hairdryers, and I'm just thinking, that's the best they can do. I mean, really, they're attacking us with hairdryers. And how much more powerful is you or me to attack the church? And it's not as though they start out and they say, you know what, I want to attack God, I want to go against God. It's this. It's going, I don't want to attack the church. Because it belongs to God. Amen. Am I going to be happy? Maybe not. Am I going to feel slighted? At some point, yes. At some point, we're all going to feel slighted. We're going to feel like, oh, they should have respected that. I can do that. That shouldn't have passed over me. And all of us will, at some point, feel like that. And the question has to come back, are we really serving God if we're saying we're serving God to our fulfillment? If we're serving God so that we can be satisfied, I've got a calling to everything I want to do. I've got a calling to everything that makes me feel good. I have a calling to do those things that lift me up. Because Jesus gave us all a calling. He called us all to be servants. And it's open to everybody. So, if we leave here and we understand not only that we have great power for good, I don't want you to come away and go, oh, we're only negative. Okay. I want you to understand that some atheist with a hairdryer is more funny than actually challenging us. Some Christian fighting, saying, I didn't get my way, I'm gonna take it down. I'm gonna attack. I'm gonna rise up. Rebellion is very effective. And most of us would agree that none of us would ever do it intentionally. I mean, I don't think any of us is as mean and vengeful that we would intentionally go, you know what, I'm going to spite God. I'm going to attack this church. But we would. We'd say, I feel slighted, I'm going to attack this church because, you know what, it's me. I got hurt. It's me. I don't know. It's me. But the great news is, in the middle of realizing that we are the most powerful force against the church, we are also the church. We are also the church, and when we talk about them not getting able to rebuild the temple and these chairs, because some of us might get to be these chairs. You know, you don't feel like you can do, you know, whatever church chairs do, but you know that you can do something. And God doesn't say that He's going to give people, and He's going to go, there's certain people who are qualified to serve me and everybody else. You know, you don't really have anything for me. Believe in me, live your life, kind of ignore the rest. We're all called to serve God, and we're all called to serve God differently. Being a church chair or a pew, you know, we serve where we can. Tonight we have an invitation from Acts 5:13. Philip went down to the city of Samaria and proclaimed to them the Christ. And the crowds with one accord paid attention to what was being said by Philip. Remember, Philip's nobody. Philip, when they heard him, saw the signs that he did, for unclean spirits crying out with a loud voice came out of many who had them. And many who were paralyzed or lame were healed. So there was much joy in that city. But there was a man named Simon, who had previously practiced magic in the city and amazed the people of Samaria, saying that he himself was something great. They all paid attention to him, from the least to the greatest, saying, this man is the power of God that is called great. And they paid attention to him because for a long time he amazed them with his magic. But when they believed Philip, as he preached good news about the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus Christ, they were baptized, both men and women. Even Simon himself believed. And after being baptized, he continued with Philip, and seeing signs and great miracles performed, he was amazed. Now when the apostles of Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God, they sent to them Peter and John, who came down and prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit. There's two characters in there. Philip, not an apostle, hangs out with the apostles. He is around Peter. He's around all these things. And you know what he did? He served. He didn't say, you know what, I'm not one of the apostles. I'm not one of those that are truly great. I'm going to sit back. He actually goes out and he does what he can. Comes across Simon. And Simon, who thought himself something great, all of a sudden figured out there's something greater. Because Philip, nobody, goes out there and decides that he had something to say. And every one of us is called to be missionaries. Every one of us is called to be evangelists. And every one of us has the ability to share Jesus. Today we have an invitation to be joined, just like Simon. Simon, who was something great, but then he found out there was something great. Who could confess that Jesus is Lord, repent of what he thought he was, his wickedness. Confess Jesus as Lord openly. To be buried with him in baptism and raised to a new life. And to be a child of God at that point who lives for God. That invitation is open. There's the invitation of just praying for one another. If anybody needs prayers tonight, and if anybody wants to submit to the eldership, we ask you to come now as we stand, as we sing.